give a person a pill, secretly made of sugar, for depression, pain, or other illnesses, and a large number of people will report they feel much better. It's fascinating, confusing, and to people trying to study medications, often annoying. But is that all there is to it? Here to discuss some of his and other people's thoughts about the placebo effect and what it tells us about the power of the mind to influence the brain, our special guest all this week, Dr. Norman Doidge, psychiatrist and author of The Brain That Changes Itself. Once more with feeling, here we go on day five for you here. Placebos, what are they?
You describe them pretty well. They are an inert substance, a substance not thought to be medically effective, that we give to a person without telling them that they are ineffective, and which actually improve their symptoms.
We've heard them referred to as sugar pills. Are they really made out of sugar?
They can be made out of different things, as long as they're ineffective.
And how was it initially discovered that a placebo might actually have an impact?
It's actually an interesting story, because like most things in medicine that are interesting, it was an accident. In the 1920s, doctors tried to become much more systematic about how they investigated and chose medications. Till then, it was often based on a tradition or the doctor's own anecdotal experience with particular medications. And so they set up the first clinical trials, and they might get 100 people and give half of them the medication, and the other half they wouldn't give anything. And of course, the patients all had some kind of illness. And what they found soon enough was that the patients who weren't getting medication said, "Why am I in this study?" And they started to drop out. So then the devious doctors decided to give them an inert substance to keep them in the study so that they could really do a comparison. And they thought they'd solve the problem. But they were clever by half, because it turned out that the patients who were getting the inert substance, which came to be called the placebo, many of them actually did get better.
They improved too.
So we're back to the drawing board. And so it goes to show doctors not only struggle sometimes to come up with effective treatments, but we struggle to come up with ineffective treatments as well.
Can you predict who will respond to a placebo treatment?
You know, people thought so. They tended to think that because this was obviously some kind of, that the mind would be involved in this, that you would be more neurotic, unstable, immature, childlike. But that actually hasn't panned out. It's hard to predict who will respond to a placebo at this point. And different people might respond to different placebos for different illnesses.
Sure. Is the placebo response, generally speaking, equally the same regardless of the illness?
No, actually. At least in our culture, it's strong for Parkinson's, depression, anxiety, ulcers, irritable bowel, arthritis, for instance. And it's not particularly effective in cancer survival, for viruses, infertility, and it doesn't work on newborns. So it varies. Now, that might vary from culture to culture, but that's what we find here.
Makes sense it doesn't work with newborns, because they haven't got the faculties to be fooled by it, right?
It leads us to believe that it has to do with our faculties.
How often do doctors, as far as you know, use placebos?
There's intentionally and unintentionally. Intentionally, for me, in 30 years of studying medicine, psychiatry, I've never seen it done. I've never done it. I've never heard someone tell me that they've done it in North America. I was trained in New York and
really?
Toronto.
So you've never prescribed a placebo for somebody?
No, not knowingly.
Not knowingly. Interesting. What does that mean?
Well, I might have given them something that really wasn't helpful to them. I might have given them a drug, and they might have responded anyway. I mean, I can explain that when I explain how placebos work, but, let me explain that right now.
Sure.
Let's say we had 200 people, and they all had depression. So I'm gonna use stats that come from real studies. Let's say I gave 100 people with depression a sugar pill. In a recent study in the American Journal of Psychiatry, they found that 38% of those patients responded.
Responded so, positively to the sugar pill.
Yeah, their
pill
depression went symptoms down. Went down. So that's,
and they didn't know it was a sugar pill.
No, they didn't know
they thought
know
it was
that.
A real drug.
Yes.
Okay. And with the other 100?
With the other 100, of all those who got the pill,
they all got the real thing.
52% got better.
So the effect of actual pharmacological legitimate response is barely any better than the response of a placebo.
Well, in that particular study, which is quite typical of placebo response in depression, where you have a high placebo response, there was only 14% difference between those who got the active medication and those who got the inactive medication. So what that really means is, if you take a look at that 52% that got better on the real medication, we've already done a separate study that tells us that 38% of people will be placebo responders. So when we look at that 52%, probably the first 38% are placebo responders, which means that 14% are really getting the response to the medication. Now, it may not be as cut and dry as that, but it leads one to suspect that many of the people who are in that 52% are actually placebo responders.
Does that make you question the validity of the billions of dollars that go into research for, you know, prescription medicine and all of this?
Well, it makes one realize, when I said we often give placebos unintentionally, that a lot of the good effects we're getting from medications in certain diseases actually are being caused by the patient's mind. Not always, and and that 14%, if that's the number, it's really important, because for some of these people, it's the difference between life and death. So this is not an argument that says we shouldn't have antidepressants. But it reveals something. You know, the placebo is one of the partially solved or semi-unsolved mysteries of the mind, which is how powerful the mind is in some of these illnesses. Look, originally people were annoyed by the discovery of the placebo effect. They were annoyed by it because, first of all, meant that to really study a medication, you'd now have to have two arms, those who were getting the real medication and those who were getting the placebo, and that increases the expense. And it also just seems very irrational. If you have a very materialist view of the human being and think it's all about chemicals and that the mind isn't important, it's kind of annoying that there's this powerful placebo effect. It's like the grin of the Cheshire cat. It just keeps showing up for people who want to eliminate mind and brain from understanding of how certain illnesses work. But then I think drug companies acknowledged it and used it. Look, three things contribute to the placebo effect as we've understood it now. One is the patient's expectation. The higher the expectation, the more likely that the placebo response will kick in. Conditioning. If you've been to your doctor twice, he pulled out a sliver and that felt good, and then he did something else for you, gave you an antibiotic and you got better, and the third time you come in and want to have a pill, you're already in a behavioral way kind of conditioned to think good things come from my doctor. And that contributes to the placebo effect. And then there's just the general suggestion in the culture, in the doctor's office, that drugs are the way to solve problems. And drug companies know how to use that. They can make placebos stronger by adjusting the size of the pill, by the changing the color of the pill, the name of the pill, Zoloft, feel aloft, is part of generating a placebo response to an to a real substance. But let's get as much placebo in there as possible.
Let me do one more follow-up question to that two different group scenario you just gave us. Of the 52% who got better from their depression because they took real medication, how long do the effects last versus the 38% who got better even though they took sugar pills? How long do the effects of their alleviation of depression last even if they're only on sugar pills?
The general teaching of psychopharmacologists has been that placebo effects don't last that long. I can't give you an absolute number. Sometimes it doesn't last that long. But, there have been studies of some illnesses like irritable bowel syndrome where placebos have been given and have lasted into months. So they can last long enough to tell us something really, really important, that, the mind has this ability to lower certain kinds of symptoms. And so what I think we should do is not fight the placebo or think of it as an annoyance, but try to really understand what is going on, because medications also have side effects.
What have placebos taught you about the brain?
Well, one of the things they've taught me is if you look at the different brain scan studies of different of placebo, now that we have these brain scans, which I mean, they really are quite amazing. If you look at different conditions, let's say depression, pain, social anxiety, and you give people placebos, what we're finding is that the placebos turn off what I'll call the pathological circuitry of the particular condition. So in social anxiety, you have where a person gets very, very anxious in a social situation and their threat system starts to fire, their amygdala and related circuitry fires. You know, we can see that by getting people in a scanner and just imagine being at a party. If you give them a placebo, then the amygdala, that threat system, goes down. In certain kinds of depression, different illness, different circuitry, we know that the prefrontal lobes are often suppressed. The prefrontal cortex, not lobes, the prefrontal cortex is often involved in planning and making things happen, which is often hard to do when you're really depressed. So they can be suppressed. And in one placebo study, patients were given fake medication and the prefrontal lobes started to come up. And in chronic pain, we know a lot about that circuitry. And when the placebo response comes on, the parts of the brain that fire in chronic pain go down. So what we're seeing is, I mean, it's really a beautiful example of mind-brain medicine, and it's very, very specific to each condition.
We've got a few minutes left here, and I want to put one more thing on the table and give you enough time to deal with it, which is there are going to be people who say it's kind of immoral for a doctor to prescribe something that isn't real,
right,
to try to treat symptoms that are real.
Right.
How do you deal with that whole morality question?
Well, it's not my problem because I don't intentionally give placebos. Right. But I think, look, for there to be a moral conflict, a real moral quandary, there are two sides. So you look at both sides. If all you care about is transparency and truth, which is, these are very important things, it's obviously wrong. People don't come to their doctors simply for transparency and truth. They come to their doctors because they want to feel better. So look, let's say you had a terrible problem. And I had tried three medications, because I'm giving you the kind of situation which a doctor in Britain, where they use them more commonly, might use this. Let's say you had, God forbid, had a terrible pain condition. And you know, pain medications are heavy duty. They give you mental fog, they can be addictive, it's constipating, there's all sorts of problems that come with them. And I tried three of these medications on you, and you had terrible side effects, one after the other. And I thought, what am I gonna do for Steve Paikin? And then someone winked and said, just try this pill.
And it's fake.
And it's fake. And the fourth time around I gave it to you and your pain went down significantly. Would you be really upset with me?
No, because in that case, outcome is more important than transparency.
And it's probably each patient's got their own call, you know, and I, you know, how to handle it, I don't know. Maybe at the beginning of the practice you would have people sign something, maybe I'll give you a placebo. But look, it's a genuine quandary. But the more common use of placebo is the inadvertent use of placebo, where patients are getting placebo responses all the time for certain illnesses, and the doctor has forgotten that actually there probably is a placebo response going on. So I'm interested in it because I think there's real potential here over time as we understand the circuitry and understand mind-body medicine on how to make it work. And you know, there's very strange, interesting things that happen with placebos. You can have placebos with operations. People did a huge study. They did sham surgery on the knee, and patients did as well with sham surgery. They opened them up, and they didn't do anything to the knee as they did with arthroscopic debridement.
Huh.
And the other thing is that the placebo effect, interestingly enough, seems to be rising in some areas. Particularly with central nervous system drugs. There's a lot of drugs that are not coming to market because they can't beat placebo anymore. And why do you think that is? Because drug companies have been so good at marketing their drugs and saying, this will really cure you, that when patients get a pill and put it into their mouths, they're getting higher placebo effects.
Fascinating. We can't thank you enough for spending so much time with us this week on Mysteries of the Mind Week all across TVO. It's been really great. Thanks so much for your contribution.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.